artist. Performances, productions of Carmen up to 1900. I make absolutely no claim that my list is comprehensive. In fact, it's probably only a fraction of the number of productions there were. But if you, in your various researches, have details of performances in any city in the world between the premiere in Paris and 1900, I'd be very grateful if you could just check my catalogue and send along the further details. Sometimes I have the year, but no actual date. Sometimes I have almost no information at all. And I would like to make it comprehensive. It's because it's online, I can add information when it comes in. So thank you very much
for any of you who can do it. You just can't call them.
Well, it's actually through my university, but if you Google Bizet catalogue, it'll come up. You'll find it somewhere. Or you can go to my website too. Yeah. You can reach that way. Anyway, here we are. Kerry Murphy, who is very welcome here. She's been writing about French music and its reception for many years, and in many cover all sorts of ground. And she's head of department at Melbourne University Department of Music, something like that, anyway. Victoria School, is it now?
No.
Always very welcome. And she will be speaking on Carmen in Australia between 1875 and 1900, perhaps, if they can help my catalogue along.
Yes. Thank you, Hugh. And thanks also to Dick and Claire so much for inviting me and for Cardiff University as well. So, earlier this year, Carmen was performed in Sydney, Australia, on a specially designed stage jutting out onto the harbour, looking over at the Opera House. It was part of the Australian Opera, Handa Opera Productions, named after a private sponsor. They aim to produce spectacular productions of popular operas to lure in new audiences by rather obvious means, in this case, overt sexuality. Carmen was sung in English with Chinese subtitles to cater for the increasing number of Chinese tourists. As tempting as it is to analyse this production, I am going to leave it there as the sun sets over the harbour and turn to look at earlier productions of Carmen in Australia, starting with the first performance in 1879 and looking at Musgrove, Melba Williamson and Quinlan. And I'm going to focus on the portrayal and reception of the figure of Carmen. Australian audiences in the second half of the 19th century were familiar with French theatre and opera, usually in English translation, although it was not until the 1950s that a permanent opera company was established in Australia. There was, in fact, a significant amount of opera performed in the 19th century, first by sporadic local groups enhanced by visitors such as Sarah Flower, Anna Bishop, and Catherine Hayes, and then visiting opera companies. Most touring companies brought out soloists, but recruited local chorus and orchestral bands, generally from Sydney or Melbourne, and most companies toured the state capital cities of Australia, as well as the large regional towns. At times, companies overlapped, but this does not seem to have mattered. By the 1880s, quote, Melbourne, jiggling its money, became a regular bidder in the world's opera market. Empresarios darted out with foreign companies and the latest scores, all with glittering operatic repertoire of mid-19th century Europe, filled the Antipodean air. As Catherine Brisbane writes, it is a myth that Australia was isolated in the 19th century, since with the discovery of gold, it became a financial centre and quickly part of a world industry. The most significant figure in opera in colonial Australia was undoubtedly Irishman William Soren Lister. He first came to Australia from America in 1861 with soloists, a small chorus, an orchestra, and a repertoire of French, English, and Italian opera. And he stayed in Australia for the next 10 years with a few trips away and leased theatres for short periods in the principal cities and large provincial towns. Just a few details about Lister's resources. It seems that most of the orchestral parts for Lister's operas were arranged from probably the vocal score of the operas. probably either done by either of his principal conductors, the German Julius Seder or Italian Alberto Zelman. Both men had seen many of the operas before coming to Australia. When Lister does have access to the printed orchestral parts, as he did for Meyerbeer's Roma le Diable, he made sure it was widely publicised in the press. For all of the Lister productions, the parts had to be adapted to suit singers' limitations and also the restricted orchestral forces available. For instance, for many years, there was neither oboe nor bassoon player to be found in Sydney. So although it might appear as though the solution of using homemade parts was caused by the tyranny of distance or financial issues, pragmatically, it was perhaps easier to only generate the parts for the instruments you had at your disposal and leave out the numbers that were beyond the capabilities of your band. Lister's surviving libretto books give an idea of the cuts he made since he published them, especially for every performance, and he didn't want audience members following the libretto to suddenly be surprised at numbers they were missing out on. So most of the libretto books actually survive today, and they're pocketbook size, printed in Australia, and they give no information on the translation used. They were available for sale at the opera for 1 shilling, which must have been a significant source of income for the company. There were only a very few cuts to Lister's Carmen. The Australian press mentioned that for his production of Carmen, Lister was using the same vocal score as the English Carl Rosa Company production published by Henry Metzler that Paul mentioned yesterday. The Carl Rosa Company had given the first performance of Carmen in English in London in 1879 using the translation by Henry Hersey. However, Lister did not use Hersey's translation, but one published by his brother Fred, which claimed to be based on the original French. Fred also translated a number of Lecoq and Offenbach libretti for the company. This is the first page of it. And you can see here that Lister also had the sole right to perform the opera in the Australian colonies in New Zealand, which he purchased these rights from Schumann. Hersey called his translation an adaption rather than a literal translation, and as I mentioned yesterday, he reintroduced some of the spoken dialogue. Accounts of the Lister performance speak only of some recitatives. Lister's translation is generally more idiomatic than Hersey, which is not to deny that it also has some awkward passages. It's just a brief comparison of the opening of the flower song. So the Hersey, see here thy floweret treasured well, and Lister's got this flower whose freshness now has perished. So it is much more idiomatic, and throughout the translation, the whole translation is much more idiomatic. Lister had entirely new scenery painted for Carmen, and by all accounts a good orchestral band assembled, although there were the usual problems with the static and at times ill-prepared chorus. The principal singers were English mezzo-soprano Rose Hersey, daughter of the already mentioned translator Henry Hersey, local tenor Arms Beaumont, and American Guillaume Verdi, formerly William Green. They were all excellent. Rose Hersey was a founding member of the Carl Rosa Company. Her husband, Arthur Howell, came out as stage manager for the Lister production, and the company gave 19 performances of Carmen in Melbourne, 12 in Sydney, and then a few in Adelaide. This is just the silk program from Sydney, prepared for the presence of the governor in the audience, Lord Augustus Loftus. Critics and audiences were well aware of the importance of Carmen. Most were familiar with its past history and its controversy. Mérimée's original novella is often mentioned. Issues of genre are not. This work is simply seen as grand opera. It was Bizet's orchestral music that made the most dramatic effect. It was spectacularly novel. It, quote, splashed on the ears of the audience like a meteor. It was overwhelming. According to one critic, the performance of Carmen was the most important event in the annals of opera in Australia since the first production or performance of Lohengrin. And that's saying something, because the reception of Lohengrin had been rapturous. Critics discussed the potential moral depravity of the libretto. The majority, however, felt it was actually avoided by Hersey's interpretation of the role. Although Carmen is described as a gypsy of the very worst kind, often compared to the much-loved Maritana from Wallace's popular opera, the vocabulary used to describe Hersey's portrayal of Carmen includes words such as beguiling, fickle coquette, saucy witchery, archly persuasive, little female larrikin, little demon, all of which suggest that she's found to be alluring, not repulsive. And she's praised for her delicately conceived and artistically represented interpretation of Carmen. In her dress, as in her acting, there is nothing to offend the most fastidious. She is too good an artiste to demoralize such magnificent music by anything coarse or vulgar. Madame Rose Hersey, by her splendid natural talents and culture, invests the false, fickle creature she impersonates with the dignity of a heroine. So the potential for vulgarity or immorality is avoided. This was Hersey's first performance of Carmen. She had performed Maritana many times, however, and perhaps was bringing a bit of that role into her portrayal of Carmen. Anyway, it was clearly a relief to the critics, who at this point in Australian history were concerned with maintaining respectability. To quote Harold Love, they yielded to none in their insistence on the propriety of their public entertainment. In the 1860s, Lister had got rid of the prostitutes who used to frequent the opera pit by issuing the proclamation that no female was to be permitted to the opera unless in the company of a man. It's a bit dark, maybe I should. So you can see the. You can see it's no lady admitted without a gentleman.
Yeah.
And down the caption is little horse, pretty. Horse trainer, come in, I'll take you under my wing. She's trying to lure him.
The back up, can you read?
I can read, yes, fine. So by the 1870s, there was a growing bourgeoisie who came to populate the boxes and circles at the opera, and it was important to the colonial self-made gentleman for whom attending the opera was an opportunity for acquiring manners and taste that the opera remained respectable. This gentility was blown away a few months later, however, when with Carmen still in everyone's minds, a dramatic scene occurred during a Lister performance of the Huguenots in Melbourne. During the interval of the opera, an Irishman whose young French wife was having an affair with a French agent in Australia for the 1880 International Exhibition pulled out a gun and shot the couple and then himself. Illustrated Press at the time. So, Carmen continued to be performed in the last two decades of the 19th century, but in very inadequate versions. And it wasn't until the 1900 productions by George Musgrove, who was in fact Lister's nephew, that we find a production to match those of Lister. Musgrove had, however, in 1892, brought out members of the London Gaiety Theatre, augmented by locals, to perform the burlesques Carmen up to data and Faust up to date. And my colleagues Elizabeth Curtis and Michael Christovridis have a wonderful chapter on Carmen up to date, up to data, and their forthcoming book on Carmen. Carmen up to data was popular with Australian audiences, but did not make much money. Scores, a folder of costume designs by Percy Anderson and souvenir programs were left behind in Australia, but unfortunately not the marked up score or scores which would have been adapted to suit Australian audiences. Even different colonies, since an Adelaide critic complained about the infliction of very bad Melbourne gags on a long-suffering Adelaide community. So I've just got a few images of these. That's from the souvenir program. These gorgeous images. See who that is? Escamillo in drag. Before I turn to the Musgrove 1901 Carmen, just a further word about resources. From now on, it appears that the printed orchestral parts are being used. Archival material relating to Australian entrepreneurs bringing out touring companies contains many contracts for hiring of orchestral and chorus parts, and also provision of sketches for staging and costumes. Let's see this contract. I haven't found one for Carmen. This one's for Louise a bit later. You can see they've, what they've got is the orchestral parts, vocal parts for the male and female chorus, and costume designs, rough models of scenery, which must be returned to Hergel on the day after the performance. And then it says down the bottom, managers are particularly requested to impress on the orchestral conductor to see that the members of the orchestra do not deteriorate the orchestral parts, and that they restrain from drawing obscene inscriptions. Which Dick referred to the brass players doing such on his opening remarks. Australian entrepreneurs then had to pay an insurance for the shipping of all the material and to make sure it was returned in good shape, as is hinted there. Otherwise, they wouldn't get back their substantial deposit. Obviously, this did not always happen, as this letter from Durand. Williamson and Musgrove have obviously written and saying, why haven't we got back our deposit? You know, we've returned all the material to you and we haven't got back our deposit. He said, well, there was a few things missing in the material you didn't return to us. There was a vocal score, the Glockenspiel part, one of the 8 female chorus parts. If you like, we'll work out what the cost of all these are and deduct it from your deposit and send you the remaining money. It must have been very hard to call everything in and return it, I would imagine. So I would imagine these sort of letters were fairly frequent. I have looked at many of Musgrove's business letters from the early 20th century, and they show he was always on the lookout for sets and costumes which could be purchased in London as, quote, old material at cheap rates. He's also often sending out in advance prompt books and rough scene and costume designs and chorus parts so that the local singers could learn their parts before the travelling company arrived. In the late 19th century, early 20th century, Musgrove moved between London and Australia, putting on opera, drama, musicals and pantomimes. And he recruited his 1901 orchestral touring opera company in England, 16 principals, but also 6 orchestral players and a set of wind instruments tuned at the continental pitch, as opposed to the high British pitch commonly used in Australia at this time. Herr Gustav Slapowski, English despite his name, came out as conductor, and he'd been conductor with the Carl Rosa Company. And there were comments in the press relating to finally the use of the true orchestral score. Musgrove also employed well-known design artist Philip Gocher to do the sets for him. The role of Carmen was sung by the Swedish contralto Agnes Janssen, who had sung at Covent Garden and had just played Carmen in America to much success. This time, there is little discussion of issues of morality. Janssen apparently evaded them by her manner of interpretation and is praised in a similar manner to Rose Hersey for her gay impudence and high animal spirits. One critic even wrote approvingly her first scholarly conception of the role. In this Australian studio photo of her, however, you wonder how she's remaining upright. The number of empty bottles. Australian artist Lionel Lindsay was in the audience for one of her first performances and was so taken by Janssen he sent her his artistic impression of how she looked, and he became obsessed with Spain, got himself there by ship the following year, where he worked on illustrations for a projected English version of Mirame's Carmen. And I can't resist showing you a few of the illustrations, which didn't get published, but has since been published by his nephew. There's some really lovely etchings in there. Janssen, by the way, later returned to Australia and taught at the Melbourne Conservatorium for 20 years. In 1907, Musgrove was back with another season, but this time with a German opera company. The German opera lovers, music lovers of Melbourne had drawn up a subscription to enable Musgrove to bring out German singers, chiefly for performances of Wagner. But they also performed Carmen and a few other works, supposedly in English, but their English was so bad that they reverted to German to the great relief of the audience. Carmen was sung by Fräulein Johanna Heinz. I can only, this is the only image I could find of her, which is of Brunhilde. Critics repeatedly described her Carmen as no dainty creature with trim dress and butterfly manners, but a full-blooded, passionate coquette who captures José by power rather than charm. She subjugates by sheer force. And here's a cartoon of the times. Don José wonders in German-Spanish if he can support life with Donna Carmen Heinz. Don José has found things insupportable and has given Donna Carmen the most unkindest cut of all, caramba. On the whole, it appears that audiences and critics did not really warm to Heinz, although as one critic commented with approval, with consummate judgment, Heinz steered clear of any exhibition of sympathy in the interpretation of this moral lacking and degenerate character, suggesting that Heinz's lack of empathy was intentional. Before looking at the Williamson-Melba Carmen of 1911, it's important to note that in 1910, Emma Calvey toured Australia, and she gave concerts with a tenor and a pianist. They were semi-stage, but they had props and costumes, and of course included numbers from Carmen. And Australian audiences were overwhelmed by her seductive manner and found her, on the whole, irresistible, although at times alarmingly realist. On her last night in Sydney, her fierce rage with Don José caused her to hurl chairs from the platform into the audience and dash his sword and helmet to the floor. So Calvé's performances were fresh in everyone's mind when in 1911, Melba's Italian opera company toured under the auspices of Australian-based entrepreneur J.C. Williamson. Singers were recruited from all the major opera houses in Europe and America. Locals were used for chorus and orchestra, and some of the costumes kindly lent by George Musgrove. Local music shops took advantage of Melba's name to advertise in the program. This is a flyer for the production. So here's some of the advertisements that you find in the program. So they were selling, first of all the operas she performed were sold, and then the recordings she'd made, some of the operas that were performed were also sold. And I'm sure Melba had a hand in this publicity. The role of Carmen in the Melba season was sung by Eleonora de Cisneros, née Broadford. Cisneros had sung on European stages and was very popular in America. Her costumes for Carmen were not Musgrove hand-me-downs, but designed by Paris couturier Jeanne Paquin. Melba, of course, often had her costumes designed by Worth, so she would have approved of this. 6'2" tall, with red hair, Cisneros was spirited and friendly and had great popular appeal. Before her departure, she was presented by members of the gallery with a brooch of a kookaburra in gold set with pearls and turquoise. And on her last night in Sydney, the gallery bombarded her with streamers and flowers and sang for "She's a Jolly Good Fellow." These first two photos were taken by Australian photographer May Moore. I presume this is a Carmen image. And there she is as Delilah. Again, a Carmen costume. She also later recorded excerpts from Carmen. Appreciated more for her acting than for her singing, Cisneros was constantly compared to Calvé, and on the whole, fairly favorably. Her interpretation, like Calvé's, was of a true daughter of the soil, with hot blood pulsating madly through her veins, immediately responsive to any caprice of passion. For her, love comes not as the darts of perfidious Cupid, by what the French call uncontrollable passion. She convincingly played a thoroughly bad lot. However, once again, like Carmen's in Australia before her, was praised for not descending to coarseness. She displayed sensuality without animalism. So now I come to my last Carmen before the First World War, which is performances by the English entrepreneur Thomas Quinlan, his travelling opera companies, two extraordinary tours of Greater Britain in 1912, 1913, singing in English to English-speaking peoples all the time, never leaving the red portions of the geographical map. He brought out roughly 163 singers, 60 chorus members, an orchestra of 55, and all the costumes, properties, scenery required for a full season with a repertoire of 25 operas. So that shows the punishing schedule they set themselves. So that obviously started on the Saturday, Sunday often. Rigoletto, the next day Rheingold, next day Tales of Hoffmann, next day Tosca. And when you get to a Wednesday, they had a matinee and an evening performance, and so on. It's an unbelievable schedule. This touring company was clearly the largest ever to tour Australia, and like Melba's tour was managed by J.C. Williamson. Here's a little picture of them getting off the boat. And that's not the full picture, because unfortunately it's torn. It was from a newspaper clipping, and it's torn just on the edge there, so it continues an operatic invasion. Basically, with Quinlan, we're looking at something quite new. We're looking at a well-rehearsed or cohesive band, singers, orchestra, and chorus that have been performing together for months. This is not a company of big names, but a company of competent, proficient singers who perhaps, because of the lack of divas, all got on very well. And Australians were completely bowled over by the general overall high standard. It was cohesive, never before experienced. So Carmen was appreciated, like all the other operas they performed, for the overall experience. The two Carmen singers singing Carmen were Rosina Bayon, a Welsh singer, and Vera Courtney, an American of French parentage, renowned for her role in Massenet's Manon. But most of the performances were actually sung by Bayon. Bayon was felt, however, to be lacking in fire. She displayed shrewdness, mild vulgarity, archness, but a feminine intensity of passion, with the implication this was weaker than what was required. So we've gone full circle. The first performances of Carmen created waves of moral angst amongst the Australian critics, which were thankfully allayed by the tasteful interpretations of Hersey. Subsequent performers were caught up with slightly confusing moral issues. Critics did want their Carmen to be alluring and seductive, which poor Fräulein Heinz clearly wasn't. But there was still the problem for some in that if you were attracted by their character, you were approving of her depravity, you were sympathising with her. Despite prior rumours that Calvé's interpretation was too animalistic, in the flesh she proved to be irresistible and convinced audiences that this was more the real Carmen than the dainty, vivacious butterfly previously approved. So now passion and sensuality was needed in the interpretation, as long as it didn't descend into coarseness and bad taste. So Quinlan's chief Carmen was found to be lacking in passion. What critics meant by bad taste was probably too much overt sexuality. However, during the second half of the 19th century, the same audiences that were attending the opera were also attending pantomime and vaudeville, where they would unquestionably have experienced elements of bad taste and vulgarity. So clearly the genre made the difference. What was acceptable in pantomime would have run contrary to the civilising pressures of opera. We started off with Lister's homemade parts, what did they sound like, and progressed to the use of proper orchestral parts, but we still had problems of uneven performance standards, with choruses in particular who just joined in at the end and were uneasy about how to move on stage. Also orchestras with central players missing and compromises made. Well, Quinlan's company, even if Carmen herself was found lacking, performance standards had reached a new high and left audiences crying out for more, and in particular for the creation of a permanent opera company in Australia, as I said, not to happen for another 40 years. Carmen had now entered into the standard operatic repertoire of Australia. It's obviously still there. And to return to the recent opera on the harbour production, issues of good taste are clearly no longer an issue.
Would you mind if we left the questions to the round table?
Yeah,
because we've got plenty of of time at the end of the
afternoon,
and I'm sure we've all got questions, but I think we need to have to get to lunch.
I think that's
and then
a good
we can
idea.
Pick that up.
Yep.
It's afternoon.
Good idea.
Right.
So another round of applause.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
My only question I can ask you to do it.
So if I could, if you'll be so kind as to move swiftly, that's an area raise it, and hopefully we'll have something to eat. You could, but I would take it. Thank you.
I would.
So many are, I can't wait.
It's definitely going to take a lot of time. So it's a bit of